welcome members, press and public to the first meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2015. And can I ask all those present to ensure that all electronic items are switched to flight mode so that they do not affect the work of this committee? We have apologies today for obvious reasons from Tavish Scott, who's found difficulty due to the weather conditions to get here from Shetland. And we also have apologies from David Torrance, who is having difficulties due to weather conditions coming from Fife. We do hope that David will join us later in the morning. So before I invite the committee's new members to declare any relevant interests, I would like to put on record my thanks and the thanks of the Public Audit Committee to Hugh Henry, Ken McIntosh and Gil Patterson for their work on this committee. So can I now invite Paul Martin, Stuart McMillan and Drew Smith in that order to declare any relevant interests to the remit of this committee? Paul?
I have no interest to declare.
Stuart?
No interest to declare.
Thank you. And Drew?
No relevant interest.
That's excellent. That was very straightforward. And can I now invite nominations for the position of convener of the Public Audit Committee? Drew?
Thank you. Maybe can I nominate Paul Martin?
Certainly. Are there any further nominations? Well, can I now confirm that Paul Martin has been nominated as convener of the Public Audit Committee and ask the committee to agree to this nomination? Thank you. Now, the committee have agreed. Can I congratulate you, Paul, and look forward to working with you on this committee. Thank you.
And thank you, Mary. And can I take this opportunity to thank colleagues for the election as convener of the committee? I look very forward to working with the committee. And can I also take this opportunity to thank Hugh Henry for his previous, previous two roles as convener, because I think he was convener before that, and also to the previous members of the committee for their work. And we have a great deal ahead of us, so can I move quickly to agenda item number three? And the question is, colleagues, that we take agenda items number 8 and 9 in private. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, and can I move to agenda item number 4, colleagues, and welcome our panel this morning. Can I firstly welcome Paul Gray, Director General, Health and Social Care, the Scottish Government and Chief Executive of NHS Scotland. Can I welcome John Matheson, Director of Finance for eHealth and Analytics, the Scottish Government. Alan Hunter, NHS Scotland, Performance Director. And Dr Aileen Keel, CBE, Acting Chief Medical Officer, Scottish Government. Panel members, you're welcome this morning. I understand we'll hear a short presentation from Paul Gray that will take no longer than 5 minutes. Mr Gray.
Thank you, Convener, and congratulations to you on your appointment to this very important role. I'm grateful for the opportunity to make opening remarks, and I'll comment on three key messages raised in the Audit Scotland report. I think the first thing to say is that there is a challenging scale of change to meet the 2020 vision. The 2020 vision is that everyone is able to live longer, healthier lives at home or in a homely setting by 2020. We'll have a healthcare system which has integrated health and social care and a focus on prevention, anticipation and supported self-management. We want to provide care as we do at the present to highest standards of quality and safety, with the person at the centre of all the decisions. And as we work to achieve sustainable quality in the delivery of healthcare services across Scotland, we want to continue to deliver improvements in the health and well-being of the people of Scotland. So on the specific issue of the demands on the health service and rising expectations, as Audit Scotland notes, demands are increasing as the result of demographic change, particularly the growing population of elderly and very elderly people, and the number of people with multiple long-term conditions and people's rising expectations of health care. We recognise the significant demands faced by NHS Scotland, and I welcome the opportunity to discuss how we are addressing these demands proactively. The integration of health and social care services, which I've mentioned, is crucial to meeting these demands. The Public Bodies Joint Working Scotland Act 2014 comes into effect from April 2015 and puts in place a framework to make sure that health and social care services are planned, resourced and delivered by NHS boards and local authorities together, working with partners in the voluntary sector too, to improve outcomes for people using the service and for their carers and families. These shadow integrated arrangements are being set up and developing their integration schemes, which must be submitted to ministers for approval. Integration authorities must be fully functioning by 1st of April 2016. In terms of Audit Scotland's references to financial pressures and waiting times, NHS boards in Scotland delivered a small surplus of £23.4 million against an overall budget of £11.1 billion. All boards have achieved their financial targets in the year in question. That's the sixth consecutive year, and all boards are on track to achieve balance in 2014-15. Audit Scotland refers to the financial pressures faced by NHS Scotland and the need to increase the focus on longer-term financial planning. We do continue to improve our practices, and we believe that we have a strong and effective focus on long-term financial planning, and this is demonstrated by the achievement of all boards meeting their financial targets. We've made brokerage arrangements on an exceptional basis, and only where a board has demonstrated its ability to repay in full. I do want to say that we take the publication of Section 22 reports by the Auditor General for Scotland very seriously indeed, and we will continue to make progress towards addressing the issues raised. We undertake in-depth reviews of all NHS boards' 3- and 5-year financial plans regularly, including detailed validation of the core financial planning assumptions. We have ongoing monthly monitoring and reporting at NHS Scotland level to ensure that financial performance is on track and that we take appropriate action in the event of any significant deviation from plans. On waiting times, the Government remains committed to supporting NHS Scotland boards to deliver the standards set in Scotland. Our waiting time standards are among the strongest in the world, and performance in Scotland is among the best on record. But there are challenges, and we do recognise these. And in this year's local delivery plans, we've focused NHS boards' improvement activity on outpatient waiting times. Just in closing then, Convener, I welcome the acknowledgement in the Audit Scotland report of the good progress of the NHS in a number of areas, including improved outcomes for people with cancer or heart disease and in reducing healthcare-associated infections. NHS Scotland's recent achievements include world leadership in using improvement science to deliver outstanding results. And this has really only been made possible through the huge contribution of patients, carers, families and volunteers, as well as the dedication of the workforce. Convener, I'm grateful for the opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Gray. Before I invite questions from members, remind members that case study 3 on page 15 of the EGS report on NHS 24, which is also a separate Section 22 report in its own right, is currently sub judice, and members may wish therefore to note this when taking into consideration the questions that they may wish to bring forward. Can I first of all bring Mary Scanlon in to ask the first question?
Thank you, and can I thank you, Mr. Gray, for your opening statement. I don't think there's anyone around this table that doesn't agree with the improvements in health and well-being. That's something we all want to see. But as the Audit Committee in this Parliament, we're looking for measurable outcomes. And I would have to say that the 8 years I spent on the Health Committee, 99 through, we were also looking for measurable outcomes, and we didn't find them then. So because of that, the previous convener, Hugh Henry, we wrote to you some time ago to ask you that we consider NHS performance measures should be transparent and clearly understood so patients, NHS staff and other interested stakeholders can easily assess the quality of care and timescales within the NHS, within which the NHS is treating patients. It was actually my questions on what is a target and what is a standard, and I think the Cabinet Secretary, previous Cabinet Secretary, agreed that it can be confusing what's a target and what's a standard. So we asked you to respond to that, and the response is, as I can see it, 38 pages of bureaucratic fudge, and I'm no further forward to understanding a measurable outcome than I was in May 1999. My question, I really thought this was going to be helpful to this committee, Can you tell me how 38 pages can help us to measure outcomes?
The, one of the outcomes that we are achieving is a significant and regular reduction in hospital standardised mortality ratios. That means that the mortality in hospitals is reducing over time. I believe that is an outcome which is of value to patients and the people of Scotland. Ms Scanlon, I am genuinely happy to try to assist the committee further here. We are not trying to make this difficult to understand. If there's something further we can do, I will be very pleased to do it.
It used to be that if a target wasn't met, it became a standard. That's what we had. Targets changed to standards. So you were going to simplify this. Now, what I want is not just that this committee will understand it, but people will, throughout Scotland will understand the improvements that we're seeing in health and well-being. Can you tell me today, how does this 38 pages of bureaucratic fudge, just tell me, I'm happy to accept your answer, can you tell me how this makes, how this simplifies our understanding and the understanding of the people of Scotland, how our health service is improving? We know when we have a target and it's not being met, we know where we're going. And if I can just say, no health board achieved the outpatient target of 12 weeks. 5 out of 14 health boards achieved the inpatient day case treatment time. 5 out of 14 achieved the A&E 4-hour target. 5 out of 14 achieved the cancer urgent referral treatment. And 3 out of 14 health boards achieved the delayed discharge target. Now, it's not a great record, but next year we can say, well, that was the target, it wasn't achieved, but here are the improvements being made. Can you tell me how that's been simplified by this?
Well, as I've said to the committee, I'm happy to provide whatever further information the committee wants. A target is something that we are aspiring to meet. It is challenging, but that's why we set it. A standard is something that should be met consistently by the NHS. That's the way we seek to set these things out. We have a number of heat targets. We have issued local delivery plan guidance to boards on both targets and standards. You mentioned outpatient waiting times. I think I said in my opening remarks that one of the areas of focus for improvement we've set for boards is indeed outpatient waiting times. If there is a simpler way that we can present this, I'm happy to reflect on it on behalf of the committee. I take your point seriously, Ms Scanlon, and we'll review that documentation, and if we can simplify it for the committee, we'll certainly do that.
Right. Just finally, on this point, I'd like just to come to section 22 before moving on. What is the difference between a target, a standard and a priority?
A target is...
And will you continue to have all of them in future?
Well, a target, as I've said, is that we are aspiring to meet it. So we have a target of meeting 95% of people seen and treated in accident and emergency within 4 hours. That's a target. We have certain standards that we've set. I can go over these, and colleagues in performance can help us with this if necessary. We have, for example, given priority in the local delivery plans this year to improving outpatient waiting time. So that's a priority that we've set for the boards this year based on the area that we, an area that we believe requires improvement. So that's the way we seek to divide these things up.
Priorities, standards and targets. Can I just, you mentioned the section 22 that you take seriously, and you'll be aware, Mr Gray, that this committee is going to Inverness to take evidence from NHS Highland. I've been quite vocal on the National Resource Allocation funding formula, and NHS Highland, and indeed Grampian, but we'll just talk about NHS Highland, has not received its full funding formula, and I have no doubt that's perhaps credited to some of the problems they're facing just now. Given all the difficulties NHS Highland are facing, as well as the Section 22 report by the Auditor General, which is a very serious matter, why was it in the middle of winter that suddenly the Scottish Government came up with the money to meet the funding, given that they've been crying out for it for many years? Why was the money suddenly found last week when they've had to struggle over many years because they haven't been funded in accordance with the funding formula?
I'll ask Mr Matheson to comment in more detail, but of course the committee will be aware that there was a decision on the distribution of the Barnett consequentials, which did provide additional resource for the NHS in Scotland, and the additional funding for NHS Highland was part of that. So when that money became available, it was distributed appropriately. But Mr Matheson would...
was based on the additional NHS spending at Westminster, which made money available in Scotland.
I'll ask Mr Matheson to give you the detail of it. It'll come on automatically. It'll be automatic, John.
Come on. Thank you, Ms Scanlon. We have a commitment within the Scottish Government that we will move boards towards NRAP parity, but do it in a measured way that doesn't destabilise those boards which are above parity. And the commitment that was given by the previous Cabinet Secretary was that all boards would be within 1% of parity by a fiscal year 2016-17. What the additional consequentials have given us the opportunity to do is to accelerate that progress, and all boards will now be within 1% of parity by fiscal year 2015-16, that we start on the 1st of April. That's based on the current formula, and as we've previously discussed at this committee, that formula is a dynamic formula. So, for example, we did recently review the remote and rural weighting within the formula, and that was beneficial to NHS Highland. The result of that is that NHS Highland for 15-16 will get an uplift of 4.7%, so second only to Grampian in terms of the scale of the uplift, and they will get an additional £24 million. In terms of the brokerage that they got last year, £2.5 million, it's important that all boards are made aware of their budget at the earliest possible opportunity. And we do that in terms of giving them advance notification. We do that in terms of working collegiately across NHS Scotland so their planning assumptions are consistent around potential pressures around superannuation, etc. So we give them that assistance. We give them the information at the earliest possible point. We try and minimise the compartmentalisation of their allocation. So we do try and bundle it round about themes rather than trying to give them individual allocations. We try to give them their allocation as early as possible in the year. So NHS Highland were clear about what their allocation was. They approached us towards the end of the year looking for assistance. We gave them assistance, as Mr Gray has indicated. That assistance is predicated on us having reassurance that they've got a robust plan going forward, and that robust plan included the repayment of that brokerage. We have now been able to give them further assistance in terms of an enhanced uplift, and we're working closely with NHS Highland in terms of their financial planning going forward.
Okay, but before I bring in Colm Beattie, can I just go back, Mr Gray, to the point you made about the way in which the targets are presented, and Mary Scanlon had raised issues about the public and how that's presented to the public. You advise that that's something that you would come back to the committee on. Is there a timescale attached to that as to when you would expect the committee to receive that? and do you accept that the information could be packaged in a more effective manner to present it more effectively to the public?
Well, first of all, convener, is there a timescale that would be helpful to the committee?
Yeah, so perhaps we could write to you with a timescale on that.
I'd be happy to conform to that, whatever will be most helpful to the committee. In terms of your question about could it be more helpfully presented, I'm sure we could always improve. It's never been my stance to say that nothing can be made better. So, for example, picking an LDP standard that we have at the moment, at least 80% of pregnant women in each SIMD quintile will have booked for antenatal care by the 12th week of gestation. I think I just about understand what that means, but I'm sure we could make that I'm just using that as a simple example. There's something we could make a bit clearer in a descriptive way. Of course, we have to be precise in the statement of the target. even things like the 18 weeks referral to treatment for specialist child and adolescent mental health services, we have to do that 90% of the time. it's probably helpful to people receiving these services to know what that means in practice for them. So I'm sure there are areas where we could look at the way that we perhaps describe more fully what the targets and standards mean.
Okay, thank you. We'll write to a timescale on that. Colin Beattie.
Can I start just by asking a clarification? Mr Gray's submission of the 4th of December refers to formula capital. It's not a term I've heard before. What does it mean?
I'll ask my accounting expert to explain it. Maybe that's something else we could explain more clearly for the committee.
Thank you. Formula capital is the capital that is allocated to boards to deal with routine maintenance, so backlog maintenance, purchase of equipment. The differentiation is between that and capital that is allocated for major projects, such as the South Glasgow development, £824 million. So there would be a dedicated sum allocated for that particular project. But for formula capital, it's allocated on a Formula 8 basis, as the name suggests, using the NRAC formula. So each board will get a share of a total pot. And the formula capital for 15-16 is a £15 million extra compared with 14-15. So the formula capital allocation is going up, and a particular area of focus in terms of the utilisation of that is dealing with backlog maintenance.
So terminology to cover capital for major projects, just in case that comes up. Excellent. Looking at paragraph 33 of the report, NHS Scotland 2013-14, I'm just looking at the increases in outpatient appointments and so on. I mean, 34% up in 4 years. Now, we talk about rising expectations and so forth as far as health is concerned. This seems like a huge increase, just to put it around rising expectations as to health. And it's also a big increase even if you take into account the fact we're all living longer. I mean, 34%, that's an awful lot. Do we actually have a full grasp of what the reason behind that is?
I'll ask Aileen Keel to give you some more detail, but of course one of the reasons I think that will be part of this is that we are trying to treat more people on an outpatient basis rather than having them treated on an inpatient basis. So there will be some structural change to the way that we're doing this. But Dr. Keel.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Gray. I think the main reason is the demographic change, the ageing population, and the fact that as people live longer, they develop more chronic diseases, have more comorbidities, and therefore require in many cases, multiple outpatient clinic referrals. So I think that is the major explanation. There may be others around that we don't understand quite so well. But I think you need to look no further than the ageing population to explain that significant increase in outpatient referrals.
I mean, that feeds through into paragraph 35, which talks about delayed discharges, and that seems to relate mainly to patients over 75 who've got complex needs. We've commented before in this committee that the transfer of resources from the NHS into primary care doesn't seem to be happening at the pace that's needed. And I would ask, are we in a chicken and egg situation where we need to build capacity in primary care to be able to cope with the patients being discharged that they will need to look after with their complex needs and so on? And at the same time, you know, how do we transfer the resources from NHS in such a way that the NHS can still handle that period of transition, if that makes sense?
No, it makes perfect sense, Mr. Beattie. Well, I'll come to John Matheson in a second on the primary care funding, because I know there's already been an announcement about some of that. I think the delayed discharge situation is complex. Of course, there is additional demand on primary care, but there's also demand on social care and the availability either of care home places or care at home. And our 2020 vision that I mentioned looks towards having more people living longer, healthier lives in home or a homely setting. that's why the integration of health and social care is so important. And I know that there's been 18 million of additional funding announced recently in relation to helping with that programme and to support some of the pressures faced. And there's a further 10 million available for distribution this financial year. So we are the government is taking this very seriously, because it is clearly better for people to be at home or in a homely setting than to be in hospital once they're well enough to go. In terms of funding for primary care, Mr. Matheson, I wonder if you might just say something to the committee about what's proposed for next year in particular in relation to that.
Thank you. As part of the draft budget for 2015-16, there's a dedicated sum of money set aside called the Integration Fund, and the totality of that fund is £173.5 million. £100 million of that is going into board baselines, and of the remaining element, there's £40 million per annum being identified and prioritised towards primary care. There's also £5 million being identified for the development of mental health services, and importantly, there's £10 million been identified to enhance the infrastructure around telehealth, telecare. Because, Mr. Beattie, you referred to delayed discharge, and that is an important issue that we're tackling just now. But part of the solution to delaying discharge is to delay admission in the first place. So if we can get upstream through the intelligent use of telehealth, telecare, and they keep people out of hospital, deal with chronic diseases before they require hospital admissions, then that is part of the challenge that we have. And some of the work that we're doing with partly with European funding money to try and get that approach embedded across Scotland is an area of specific focus.
In 2013-14, the budget for the NHS increased by 3% in cash terms, roughly, which equates to about a 1% real increase. But still, obviously, makes it quite a challenge to meet these sort of exponential growth in patient demand. And a number of NHS boards are clearly having problems meeting their targets. And the Auditor General has highlighted that several are doing so in an unsustainable way, which presumably refers to the fact that they're non-recurring savings. What are you doing to work with these boards to help them get onto a more sustainable basis? And I'm talking specifically about the ones that have the non-recurring savings.
The couple of responses in terms of that. Part of the answer to that very legitimate question is around long-term financial planning. So rather than just dealing with the year in question, maybe the next year, looking at where we're trying to get to in terms of three, 4 years out. Now, that is our aim. It's not helped by the fact that we've got a time-limited spending review, so the assuredness that we can give boards indication of what their budget might look like 2-3 years hence, but we can't give them assuredness. We give them that at the earliest possible opportunity, but that's dependent on the spending review cycle. We have the 2020 vision in terms of where we're trying to get to, so the strategic direction is clear. The introduction of the health and social care and integrated budgets around health and social care will assist in terms of bringing together the budget resource and how it can be used across that sector. But there are certain boards where the overall reliance within NHS Scotland generally in terms of non-recurrent reliance has been coming down. I used to use a ballpark, because there's always non-recurrent flexibility within the system. The issue is that being used on a recurring basis, or is it being used on a non-recurring basis? So you made the point earlier about trying to create some investment space in the system. So how it's been used is important. We have, going forward, a commitment to give as much clarity to boards in terms of what funding is going to come to them. In terms of the financial planning cycle, we have three-year plans signed with most territorial boards. The detail in years two and three is less rich than the detail in year one. But we do have that commitment there. There are a couple of boards at the moment that we are particularly focused on. NHS Highland is one, in terms of just looking at the level of non-recurrent commitments they have, which are not funded through a recurrent resource. So we are particularly working with the NHS Highland. We've put some specific resource into NHS Highland to work with them to look at the shape of services that they are providing. And obviously they are an early example of health and social care. So there's a potential there in terms of how they can progress that.
You touched on a very important point there, which doesn't seem to be taken really highlighted in the Auditor General's report, which is about non-recurring savings being used for non-recurring expenditure. Is that a valid point in relation to some of the NHS boards at the moment, the ones that we're looking at that apparently have non-recurring savings, which, you know, we on the face of it think could be a problem in the future because we just assume that it's against recurring expenditure?
I think Mr. Gray mentioned the overall performance of the NHS in Scotland, and against an £11 billion budget for the health boards, they were £23 million underspent. And of that £23 million, the £10 million was NHS Glasgow deliberately underspending to allow them to cover the anticipated double running costs around South Glasgow. They're just about to move into South Glasgow at the end of this month, which is fantastic. The project is on time and on budget, but there will be double running costs linked in there. So NHS Glasgow are prudently putting aside some money to recognise that double running costs. So that was £10 million of the underspend. £3 million was a similar approach from Dumfries and Galloway. Now, we within Scottish Government then try and manage that overall position within the totality of the £12 billion resource. And the underspend within the health and social care directorates for 13-14 was £4 million, which is sort of landing the helicopter on the drawing pin. But the aim there is to ensure that we are maximising the amount of healthcare that we can get from the resources we have available. And that necessitates the looking at the inevitable non-recurrent flexibility that there will be in a year and looking at how that can be managed in an appropriate way to ensure that we maximise the delivery we can get from the totality of the resource. And that requires flexibility between boards. It requires flexibility between myself and board colleagues.
So, just one last question. We beat ourselves up here about targets and so on, and percentages and whatnot. Do we have any figures how we compare with other countries, you know, south of the border, for example, or any European countries on similar statistics such as waiting times and so on? Do we have anything like that?
Mr. Hunter will be able to help you with some of that.
Yes, we do. and if we pick up on issues around unscheduled care, which clearly we... any patient waiting any length of time we want to address, but what, it is important to know the journey that we've gone in. I mean, I've been in the Scottish Government for about a year now, but prior to that I worked in acute hospitals and the health service, and since whenever I worked in the health service there was always patients waiting a long time in A&E departments, and in fact in Glasgow Royal Infirmary 10, 15 years ago patients waited routinely for long periods of time. And then what was introduced was a collaborative programme back in 2004-05 to address that. And over the years since then, there's been significant improvements. We've seen some reduction in those improvements, and there's some challenges in the system at the moment. But it is important to put it into context that Scotland's still ahead of its international and UK comparators.
Do we actually have those
figures?
Yes. The figures are that in terms of Scotland, 7.3% of Scottish patients attending A&E in September 14 waited over 4 hours on the same basis, so looking at major A&E departments. In England, 8% of patients waited over 4 hours, so a marginal difference between England and Scotland. In England, in Wales, 16.9% waited over 4 hours. Northern Ireland, 24.3% waited over 4 hours. In New Zealand, where they monitor a less ambitious 6-hour target, we monitor a 4-hour target. 6.2% of their patients waited over six hours. In Australia, 18.6% of their patients waited over 4 hours. The reason for putting that is to put it into context that whilst we need to do more and we are going to do more for the Scottish population, we are ahead of the game in terms of the pressures. Now, these pressures are coming in because of an ageing population. So we've had a 17% growth in admissions over the last 7 years. And that what is matching that admission is the growth in over 75 years population. So there's significant challenges in the system, but we're working with the Royal Colleges, the Academy of Royal Colleges, other partners to try and identify where the next change in unscheduled care and other areas. Moving on to other measures such as across the UK, we looked at, with the other UK countries, looked at 11 areas of procedures, waiting time procedures, and we standardised against that those 11 procedures, and in 9 out of the 11 procedures, Scotland was better than England, and in all 11 Scotland was better than the Wales or Northern Ireland, and that's based on the latest published stats.
Clearly, you've got quite a bit of information there. Convener, could I suggest it might be of interest to the committee to actually have that circulated to members, the comparative figures that are available, yeah, just so we can see where we are?
Yeah. Can you facilitate that, Mr.
Yes, absolutely. Okay.
Just a brief supplementary from Mary Scanlon, and then I'll bring in Stuart McMillan.
Yes, it's very brief. We're constantly hearing about the ageing population and, Mr. Gray, people being treated in a homely setting. But the report that we have in front of us today, page 40, exhibit 13, tells us that the 11% fewer, there's been a reduction of 11%, totalling 60,950 fewer people receiving home care. So given that we've got an ageing population in a homely setting, over a 5-year period, we've got an 11% reduction. We've also got a 10% reduction in care homes and a 36,500 reduction in residents in care homes. So given that we're always being told people are older, they need more home care, you know, the provision of the service is going in the opposite direction to what we're being told is the level of demand.
Well, Dr. Keel will help us with the interpretation of these numbers.
Mr. Hunter's going to help us, actually.
All right, sorry. I knew I was being nudged from the side.
Mr. Hunter? I looked at those figures as well, obviously, and needed some interpretation, so I got the position on that. Although there has been a decrease in the numbers of patients receiving home care, the actual spend and the number of complex care packages has gone up, and that's in direction with what we're trying to do. We're trying to keep more patients in their own home. There's figures that I can share that shows that's the direction of travel. So although we're seeing more complex care packages and keeping people in their own home.
So is it the case that the eligibility criteria for home care has the barriers been raised compared to when the legislation went through this Parliament in 2001?
I would come back to you on that one. I can come back to you on that. But in terms of our direction of travel, we've been wanting to keep people in their own home, there is more resource going into keeping people in their own home that matches these figures, so I can share that with the committee.
61,000 fewer people, 11% reduction. So you've got to be more ill in order to receive home care. Is that the case?
We've got more. We have got patients who are in their own home being looked after. The direction we were going in was that direction.
higher and more complex than they were 10 years ago. Is that the case?
The eligibility criteria has been changed.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Mullen.
Thank you, the convener. Good morning, panel. The first question, just as a really kind of point of clarification, obviously, as one of the new members onto the committee that's came to this from a fresh eye. And one of the submissions we got from Mr. Gray was regarding some clarification. There's the issue of the backlog, the £830 million backlog, and also the further £97.6 million relates to the properties which will be replaced with the current redevelopment projects. I'm aware that in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, at the moment, there is some discussion regarding potentially two new health centres, either one in Clyde Bank or one in Greenock. And so when I was reading this, I actually wasn't sure as to where these two current facilities would actually, which category they would fall into. Would it be for the backlog, or would it be for the new projects?
The new facilities would be capital investment, so that would not be a backlog issue. That would be a decision about where Greater Glasgow and Clyde would spend money on investing in new facilities.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for that. When I was reading through the report, a number of things kind of did strike me, one of which was, in terms of all the parties sitting around the table, that, it struck me that there's something in this for all of us, because clearly there are challenges. I mean, yourselves have already said that this morning, but that also there are some positives as well, and the report does indicate that. And also with the eye to the future, there are challenges with that too. But there's a couple of things that did strike me. It was one of which was in case study two, on page 14, and that was the situation regarding NHS Orkney and the board's spending on locum doctors increased by 30%. Also the report did go on to indicate that also there had been there are issues there in terms of actually trying to attract people to Orkney. Now, I don't know why, because it is a beautiful part of the world, but are you aware of what actions or what activities are NHS Orkney actually doing to encourage more people to get there? Do they have any flexibility to maybe offer other incentives to get people to go there to work?
Well, the island boards, of course, have, as you say, some very attractive living conditions and very attractive to people who like that kind of setting, and many do. Boards are able to offer certain incentives if they choose to do so within the overall salary and pay arrangements, terms and conditions that they have. But I think the thing that tends to make boards most attractive to people is if they are operating on a stable and effective basis. And I think that's why NHS Orkney are giving so much attention to responding to the Section 22 report that they got, to ensure that NHS Orkney is seen as a good place to work and running and delivering a viable health service, which in general it is. But Mr. Matheson will be able to say more about the support that we've been giving to NHS Orkney and the considerations that they've been undertaking.
I think, Mr. McMillan, the other factor that will make NHS Orkney more attractive is the development or the redevelopment of the Balfour Hospital within the Orkney, and that will happen over the next 2 to 3 years. The NHS Orkney has got clinical issues. So I think there's a couple of factors there. One, the point that Mr. Gray made, but the second one is looking at the potential for them to redesign the services within NHS Orkney. So a number of the islands have had the GP-led services, and whether a nurse-led service might be more attractive and easier to fill in terms of potential vacancies. In terms of the specificity around the Section 22 report, we did recognise the fact that goes back to the same principle of a small board, the level of technical accounting expertise within NHS Orkney needed a bit of specific enhancement, and we sent a colleague up from NHS Fife to give them that a dedicated support around the time of the annual accounts, but also some ongoing support beyond that. So we do try and give some central support where possible. And I know in other areas they've had support and strong connectivity with NHS Grampian around communications and other aspects of the support services they provide.
That's helpful. On paragraph 24 and paragraphs 24 and 25 regarding the capital spending. When I read this particular paragraph 25, when I read these two particular paragraphs, I immediately thought of the convener of the Local Government and Regeneration Committee, Kevin Stuart, because the words that he regularly used in that particular committee is that you can't legislate for common sense. And some of the, what's actually here, regarding paragraph 25, that looked to me as if there was a kind of a joined up approach taking place, because NHS Grampian weren't in a position to actually spend the money at that particular time, so that they wanted to put it back. Now, when I read that, I thought actually that was actually a positive thing to do, to actually work in tandem with the government. But I could also see why some people might think or might want to challenge it. Can you provide a bit more information, please, on the rationale for what actually happened there?
What we do each year within the capital programme is we deliberately overcommit at the start of the year in terms of the capital programme. So, and that is anticipating slippage. So there's a risk attached to that, but we work closely with boards in terms of how we manage that risk. So the level of overcommitment in the current year was around about £20 million, but we're still anticipating that the capital budget will come in online. We supplement the capital budget with capital receipts, so the sale of the buildings that are no longer used and required for healthcare provision. And there's obviously a risk linked to that as well in terms of the timing of capital receipts, the timing of the planning permission for developments, etc. So it's a dynamic source in terms of the funding that we have available, but we work very closely with individual boards and on a pan-Scotland basis, going back to my previous point, to make sure that we utilise the totality of the capital resource that we have available. And that requires some detailed discussions. Grampian is specifically mentioned here. But NHS Grampian have had significant capital investment over the last number of years. They've got the new emergency care centre at Aberdeen Royal Infirmary, and there was a recent commitment to develop maternity and cancer services within the Aberdeen Royal Infirmary, additional £120 million committed in respect of that. It's important that when we talk about the balance of care, we talk about primary care investment, and you were making the point about the health centre developments in Glasgow. So there's also been developments on the health service side at Forres, and also imminent developments at Inverurie. So there's a significant amount happening within the capital programme. We recognise that overall the Scottish Government capital programme, capital funding, has reduced significantly over the past few years, and we've tried to protect the health capital resource by transferring money from revenue to capital to supplement the capital resource they have available. We've obviously had a major commitment recently in terms of the £824 million South Glasgow development, and that's coming to the end of its investment programme. There's a further £30 million of that £824 to be spent in 15-16. So we work very closely with boards. We're very ably supported by the Scottish Futures Trust in taking forward our work with boards. We've just produced a 10-year capital plan. So we spoke earlier about long-term planning. We have a 10-year capital plan that's been agreed by the Cabinet Secretary, and happy to share that with the committee if that would be of interest.
Useful.
Okay. Nigel Dunn. Sorry, one more.
Thank you. Clydebank and Greenock, they're not in Glasgow, although they're a part of the same health board. They're not in Glasgow as a West of Scotland regional MSP. I want to just get that on the record.
I was referring to Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
No, that's fine. But in terms of the process that has been underway, certainly between paragraphs 24 and 25 of the report, has that been a similar process for some time, or is that maybe a recent initiative between the government and the NHS?
That approach has happened for a number of years. What we've got recently in the last 3 to 4 years, we've got a very comprehensive asset management report on the state of the NHS estate. And that's enabled us to quantify the level of backlog maintenance that was outstanding within the NHS. And when we started in 2011, and we split it between low, medium, significant and high, and the totality of that investment required was just over £1 billion. So there's been a very clear focus on that within boards over the last 2 to 3 years. And the commitment that's been given is that within 5 years, all the high and significant backlog maintenance identified in that original report will be removed. And that will be removed either by corrective action being taken in terms of the maintenance of the facilities or recognising the capital programme that we have in situ. So, for example, within Dumfries and Galloway, the new Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary will enable them to move off the existing site and therefore remove that level of backlog maintenance that's currently present within that existing site.
Okay, thank you. I've got one final question from you. Thank you. Paragraph 39 of the report regarding the co-locating of staff. And there was something that there was one of the carers centres within the West of Scotland. They've actually got a member of staff now. This happened within the last year and a half, 2 years. They now have a member of staff who has an office based at a hospital to actually assist with people who are being discharged. Now, I was very supportive of their application to get funds to ensure that actually was going to take place. Because they felt, certainly beforehand, they felt as if it would actually assist people when they are discharged and help with that whole process. Now, it's in also within the NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde area. But is that something that that you would encourage? Would you actually be looking to do more of that and do more of that working with non-statutory partners?
Yes, Mr. McMillan, we would. I think as we proceed along the path of the integration of health and social care, it's important that it's integrated from the point of view of the patient, on the carer and the family, so that they don't have to go to multiple sources of advice in different places. So the more we can do to ensure that there are single sources of advice and the advice is near the patient and the carer and the family, the better. We'd be very supportive of ensuring that approaches like that were taken forward.
Nigel Dunn.
Thank you. And good morning, colleagues. I'd like to think just a little bit further ahead, if I may. I'm conscious that any audit report is almost by definition what's happened historically and with some reference to current processes. But it seems to me that one of the current processes must be to look beyond 2020, let me say 2030, 2040. And the reason I'm saying that is because some of us, despite what our years might tell us now, I think have been around at the time, and it would appear that statisticians tell us that this is quite possible. And of course, from the health services point of view, life's just going to get more difficult. And actually, we all know that. And I'm not seeing, I think, in anything, or I haven't seen, let's put it that way, any discussion about how things are going to have to change on that timescale. And I suppose my first question, therefore, Mr. Gray, would be what level of thinking does go on, and what is your current thinking on how we're going to cope with a significantly older population, please?
Well, within the Health and Social Care Directorates, at the beginning of this month, I set up a new directorate, the Directorate of population health improvement, because I'm very clear, and with the advice of senior colleagues here, that tackling the overall health of the population is the way in which we are going to make a real contribution to addressing these future pressures that you rightly identify. We have, I think, advanced healthcare systems across the world can tell a reasonable story about how they've improved their efficiency and sustainability and the quality of the care that they've provided. But I don't think you would find an advanced healthcare system anywhere in the world that said we've cracked the issue of population health. And Scotland has particular characteristics in relation to population health, and these have been of long standing and contribute, I think, significantly to some of the deep-rooted inequalities in Scotland. So for that reason, I've taken the decision to establish this directorate, which will draw in the best clinical advice that we can get in order to ensure that we make real progress on tackling population health. It's going to take a long time and it's going to be difficult, but I suspect if I get it right, you and I will be the beneficiaries of what comes out of that.
Yes, I'm with you, but can I challenge you not on what you've said, but on since what the consequence of that is? Because if you and I and those around us have healthier lives for longer, that merely defers your health board problem, and actually then at some point that old age effect takes over. None of us likes to think about it, but we've all seen it. And then we need the medical help that you're well placed to provide. And of course, if we've actually stuck around longer, it's worse when we get there. It's more complex. The comorbidities that Dr. Keel's already spoken about are then more evident. So yes, we may be deferring it, and yes, we probably nationally have to spend less in order to get there, which is what we have to do first. But by the time we do get there, it's actually yet more complicated and yet more expensive. Now, I guess that's where I'm really trying to get us to. How on earth are we going to be able to handle that when we get there? That's probably a health committee question, but what are you doing to think about it? I would suggest as an audit committee question.
Indeed, and I'm giving you the assurance that we're on our way of thinking about it. I'm not claiming to be finished yet. Dr. Keel will have something to add in a second. I think the situation will inevitably be that end-of-life care will continue to be required. It will be complex. It will be acute. But if we can shorten the period over which that is required, then that in itself, I think, is beneficial both to the individual and the health service. I always find it very hard, for reasons the committee will understand, to put a sort of economic value on end-of-life care. It's a hugely important component of what we do. And I think we need to get better at it. We are getting better at it. But Dr. Keel, you'll have some useful things to say on this.
Hopefully. Thanks, Mr. Gray. Well, I think, first of all, before I come to the question, we've focused so far in the discussion mainly on financial and performance management issues, and they're very, very important. But they're only important as a means to an end. That's to improve clinical outcomes across patient care. And the Audit Scotland report, of course, refers to those improved outcomes. If we look back over the past 20 years, expressed in rates of mortality, reduced all-cause mortality by 36%. Cancer mortality is down by 26%. CHD, 69%. Stroke, 64%. Now, how has that been achieved? Well, it's a combination of prevention and better treatment. I mean, treatments have changed dramatically. When I started in medicine, if you had a heart attack, you were kept lying on your back in a coronary care unit for nearly 2 weeks. Now people are up within a day or two and back home. So that's just one example of how things have changed. And they will continue to change. But from where I'm sitting, what we need is an emphasis more on prevention while maintaining the ability of the NHS to deliver improved treatments as they come along. Why am I focusing on prevention? Because what I would like to see is younger people coming through, living longer, but living healthier for longer. So they're not developing all the comorbidities that the current population are developing. And they may get into quite late old age with only one or two as opposed to half a dozen. So in the end, the NHS resource required to care for them at the end of life will be less. That is the aim. And we're doing a lot around prevention. We've got lots of investment in early years, for example. Lots that we could talk about. So that is the direction of travel. Getting upstream of the health problems that face the Scottish population at the moment and stopping them developing in the younger generation.
Right. So if I've heard you were right, and I think I have seen some logical answers in there, if I might put that kindly, what you're suggesting is that we live healthier, longer lives, which has got to be good regardless. The process of then dying is actually shorter and it's probably less complicated medically because we haven't developed some of those comorbidities on the way. And then you are entitled to view when we do get to counting the beans that end of life process actually becomes cheaper and therefore becomes more manageable in health service financing terms, which is how we actually have to discuss it. Okay, and I think there is a degree in logic in there which I can understand and respect. I'm wondering, Convener, whether I could ask just one other thing, because if I could come back to Dr. Keel's original answer to the very first question, I think, which was about waiting times for outpatient appointments. I think Dr. Keel, you suggested that that was one of the effects of an ageing population, which, again, I can entirely believe. But I think, coming back to something that Mary Scanlon was saying about the comprehensibility of the numbers in front of us, I'm not sure I've seen many of these data broken down by age of the patient. Now, I don't think you necessarily want to do everything. That just makes a much bigger spreadsheet. But it might be that some of the data like that could helpfully be broken down over years by age of patient, because we might be able to see some very clear indicators of why things are arising.
I think that's a very helpful suggestion. It was already going through my mind that we need to have a closer look at what's in that. Thousands of outpatient numbers are coming forward now. I suspect they are very much in the older age groups, but we need better understanding of them.
Thank you. Just a brief supplementary from Stuart Mill, and then I'll bring in Drew Smith.
I'm happy if you want to take someone else in first.
No, I'm kidding.
Okay, thank you. It's on the long term and the future. Certainly, paragraph 69. Of the report, it highlights the issue of the longer-term financial planning, and also, I mean, there's a potential risk to that, as already has been stated. I mean, there has been a reduced level of certainly capital budget to the Scottish Parliament, to the Scottish Government, and it's anticipated there'll be less money coming to the Scottish Parliament going forward. And with everything that Dr. Keel said a moment ago, in terms of where the ideal situation would actually be. How do you actually marry up the two? If we know there is going to be less money, and we know there are going to be cuts to the Scottish Government budget, so how do you actually manage to plan for that?
Well, in response to Mr. Don's questions, I think Dr. Keel and I have been talking about something, you know, that is 10 to 20 years out in terms of delivery, although, as Dr. Keel said, we've made significant progress in quite a number of very crucial conditions. In the short term, two things perhaps to say. One is that there's a 75% correlation between delayed discharge and performance in accident and emergency. So, in other words, if you have more delayed discharges, that will put more pressure on your A&E department. That's why tackling delayed discharge is both an important short-term measure in terms of the performance of the acute sector, as well as what happens in the home or in care homes. It's critical for patients that they're out of hospital as quickly as possible. But one of the ways that we'll meet the financial pressures that we currently have is to continue on that path of improved efficiency. We're running a programme at the moment on patient flow through hospitals to ensure that that flow is as smooth and predictable as possible. Again, we've brought in someone who is a world expert in patient flow because we think this is very important. His statement, which he made at a conference that I was at recently, was that many countries are talking about improving patient flow. Scotland is actually trying to do it. I'm not going to claim success yet, but we're making a real effort in that area. So we're doing things to improve the efficiency of the system as it currently stands, while trying to marry up that planning for the long term that Mr. Don has rightly drawn attention to. And these short term initiatives will make a difference. We're putting in place a 6-point plan for the improvement of unscheduled care in hospitals. That's been we've worked very hard with the Royal Colleges on that. Mr. Hunter mentioned that earlier. So we're taking seriously the short-term improvements that we need to make, as well as planning for the longer term.
Convener, may I come in with a very brief supplementary point? Three points, I think. First of all, the protection that the health budget has been given, which mirrors the protection given by the Department of Health in England, and is welcome. And that gives us relative protection, but not absolute protection. So we still have efficiency targets to face. The focus of the committee today, understandably, has been around sort of partly around the increased resource, the additional budget consequentials, etc. I think one of the challenges we have within the NHS is to look at how effectively and efficiently we use the totality of our resource and not just the marginal increase each year. And the final point I would make is that the progress that's been identified and recognised internationally in terms of the quality of healthcare, infection rates, readmission rates, etc., is really, really important in terms of the effective use of the £12 billion. When I talk about financial performance, I talk about quality-driven financial performance, because if you get the quality right, there's a better chance of the numbers being correct. And the final point is that after staffing, the highest area of spend that we have within NHS Scotland is on prescribing. We spend about £1.4 billion on drugs. And one of our areas of focus here is around national therapeutic indicators and performance indicators in how we use that drug budget as effectively as possible.
Okay, Drew Smith.
Thank you very much, Convener. A couple of members referred to the Mr. Gray's helpful written submission on the issue of backlog earlier, and I just wanted to maybe start there. I suppose the health service is a hugely complicated thing because people are hugely complicated. But on these specific issues, primarily around buildings, I'm just interested to know why we're a year going to be a year later in clearing some of the backlogs than we forecast. We talked about anticipated slippage earlier on in relation to something else. I mean, are these forecasts, do they take into account the fact there's going to be slippage, or you know, can we just give and take a year on such forecasts?
Well, Mr. Smith, obviously we would prefer to meet the initial targets that we set ourselves in terms of backlog maintenance. Of course, some of the issues in relation to backlog maintenance are that when you start to get into a maintenance programme, you discover some issues that were not visible on the surface, and therefore things do take a bit longer. So we're close to where we wanted to be, but we're not absolutely there, and we're predicting that the high risk things will be dealt with fairly soon, and the next level down by, I think, 2016-17, all but 150 million of that. But I mean, Mr. Matheson is on top of the detail here, and I'm happy if the committee wishes that he provides further detail.
I think the other thing, Mr. Smith, that we're doing, as I mentioned earlier, is that we are trying to protecting the formula capital budget from which the source of the funding of backlog maintenance comes. So it's increasing between 14-15 and 15-16 from 146 million to 157 million. Now, that's not all on backlog maintenance. That covers equipment replacement, etc. But the commitment we've given is that we will remove all high and significant backlog maintenance that was identified in the 2011 survey within 5 years, either through actioning it and dealing with it, or through the new capital replacement. So the new Sick Children's Hospital, the new Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary, the new South Glasgow Hospital that enables the Greater Glasgow and Clyde colleagues to come off the existing York Hill site, the existing Victoria Infirmary site.
I think I was on the committee around the time when we discussed some of those issues in that survey. And I think what Mr. Grace presented in the written submission, it is encouraging. There's no doubt about that, and it does give you some reassurance, and I recognise that there's progress being made. But if we forecast something and then we don't meet it, and then we have a reassurance that we are going to meet it in 2015 and significant by 2016, it does take away your confidence in our ability to do that, and that's a challenge. I wonder if you just finally let's just say a word about maybe the proportion of this that relates to essentially surplus buildings that are unlikely to be used versus the proportion of this that is so for both high and significant, what proportion of that is in buildings that are still key to the delivery of healthcare?
I don't have that detail to hand, but I will supply that detail happily to the committee.
Okay. I wonder if we just turn to the issue, Convener, if it's acceptable of delayed discharge. And maybe back to the issue of people again. One of the things for me, we talk about delayed discharge, but when my constituents come and see me, they don't refer to their relatives as a delayed discharge. They tell me a story of an elderly relative who, perhaps towards the end of their life is experiencing a level of service from the health service, which ultimately is often life-limiting, either in that it has made their condition or the variety of their conditions worse, certainly their experience is worse, and it makes the whole experience for that person and the people around them at the end of their life not what we would want it to be. And I think we've got to... what I'm interested in is whether or not you believe that there's any more that we can do to actually understand the personal impact on human beings of some of these problems around delayed discharge, because we can measure the number of people who are delayed in leaving hospital because of lack of a care home place or because of lack of adaption at home. But do we measure the number of people who are whose health has actually been affected by that? Do we measure the fact that they are then back in contact with a GP or another specialist or back in hospital within a set period of time, or do we measure the fact that their life then ends shortly afterwards, that their family may feel their life ended sooner than it needed to because of the stresses of all these things? Are any of those things measured?
Well, first to say two things, Mr. Smith. Firstly, I'm not suggesting that you would raise it here, but if there is a particular case that comes through in your constituency caseload that you think you should draw to our attention, I would genuinely ask you to do that, because the only way we can fix problems is to know about them. So if there's particular issues, please do raise them direct. Secondly, though, the impact on individuals. The key reason that we want people not to stay in hospital longer than they need to is not about money. It's because it is not good for the individual. I'm absolutely clear about that. You will have a less good outcome if you stay in hospital longer than you need to. And the impact will be felt in either someone who stays in hospital too long being unable to return home because they've been in hospital for too long and they've lost that confidence, that facility to be at home. It will be evidence in that loss of confidence in the general way that they conduct themselves. Their families and their carers and their friends will see that. So the reason we think this is something that is worth taking very, very seriously is precisely because we already know the outcomes will be better for people who get to home or a homely setting at the right moment. Focusing then on seeking to get people discharged within 72 hours is actually ideal. Not, you know, there's 2 weeks, there's 4 weeks. These are important staging points. But 72 hours is really what we're looking at in terms of getting people out when they need to be. We're working with the 7 local partnerships that have the highest, the most significant challenges: Aberdeen, Edinburgh, Falkirk, Fife, Glasgow, Highland and South Lanarkshire. We've got people working on that today to ensure that we do more. Glasgow are actually making some good progress on something called discharge to assess. So in other words, rather than having someone waiting in hospital to be assessed, being discharged, in order for that assessment to take place, so long as it is clinically safe for that to happen. So I'd be very clear in responding to your point that we know that this does not produce good outcomes if we keep people in hospital for longer than they should be there, and that's why we're so serious about tackling it. Of course, there are financial benefits, benefits to flow through the hospital, benefits to A&E pressures and all of that, but the core point is it's better for the individual.
I mean, I wasn't trying to raise a specific case, but I think we all know from, you know, in our case, people who represent, but and, you know, people watching this, people that they know and people that they've visited in hospital that they visit, you know, towards the end of their life, that a bad experience in hospital at the end of their life can destroy someone's confidence. It can make them feel, I don't want to go back into hospital, I want to give up. And that is the experience of too many of people, and that's it's that kind of experience that I'm interested in. Do we actually attempt to measure that? Because there'll be some people who are delayed in hospital, and it doesn't have an impact on them particularly, and you know they manage that and it's fine, and they carry on. But for other people, that could just be a final hurdle towards the end of their life that can be destructive for them, literally. Personally, but so stressful for their family who experience it alongside them.
I think that's why I'm making the point. We do, of course, if there is a poor clinical outcome, then clearly through the clinical governance procedures of the hospital, that will be followed up. But what's very important, and you may not expect me to say this, but I will, what's very important is that if patients or carers or families have a complaint about the way in which they or their family member was treated, it's really important that they make that complaint at the time when it's possible, you know, close to the point to do something about it. People sometimes feel they shouldn't complain or it's not fair to complain. Now, of course, we like to be praised, but we absolutely have to know what goes wrong as well. There's an excellent patient opinion website that we're promoting in Scotland that's used across the UK, but we've got Patient Opinion Scotland, where we get a number of great stories about people who've been well treated, but we also get some very important stories about people who haven't been well treated. There's one, it happens to be an English example, but I'll use it, of someone who after 4 years has only now felt able to come forward and say where something didn't go as well as it should have done and the serious impact it had on them. They've had an excellent response. I've seen Greater Glasgow and Clyde responding very well to complaints and seeking to get in touch with the individuals concerned. So, you know, I want to keep in our minds that in the majority of cases we're doing very well, but in some cases where we don't, I do genuinely believe that it's important that we get the facts and the details from the families quickly, so that if there's something we can do to redress the problem, we get the opportunity to do it. And even if there's not, we can at least learn from what happened. That was one of the big lessons of the Vale of Leaven inquiry, that there were things that could be done that we're doing. And, you know, we don't want to wait a number of years for something like that. We want to know now.
Briefly, Convener. I mean, I suppose that absolutely there'll be instances of complaint which, you know, specific things have happened, they need to be resolved. Sure, that's appropriate. But there's also the issue of just systems and the number of people, you know, who have got into the discharge who, you know, suspect will be down to issues like the lack of a space at a care home, the lack of the appropriate adaption at home, the lack of a care package around that person to facilitate them going home, which is not really is a matter of individual complaint, but it's a systemic problem that the resources are not in the right place at the right time for individuals. And I suppose my final question on this is to the extent to which you, as the Chief Executive of the Health Service, can actually resolve all of this without. What's your sense of what level of change is required in local government? Because we want to work in partnership. That is our whole direction. But there are competing demands here, and there are competing budgetary pressures, and there are competing decisions being made. We will all be aware of local authorities who will be making cuts to warden services, to provision of care alarms and different things at home. And ultimately, it's not within your gift to solve those.
No. There are three things very briefly to say. First of all, I'm perfectly clear that I cannot, and in the health service, cannot resolve this all on its own. But second point, that's why the integrated joint boards are so important, because these discussions in the past would be about, is the health service putting pressure on local government? Is the local government decision putting pressure on the health service? An integrated joint board with an integrated budget will see that picture as a whole. And so in a situation where the health service can do something that might save pressure and cost on local government, there will now be an incentive to do that, because that will be a two-way incentive. The incentive on local government to reduce pressure on the health service will be equal, because there will be an integrated joint board with an integrated budget. So there will be a genuine budgetary and resource incentive for everyone to work in the most efficient way together. And the third thing to say is we must continue, at the risk of repeating myself, to put the person at the centre of this. This is about a better service for people. And the thing that I'm pressing at the moment with colleagues who are responsible for these areas is to ensure that we continue, in thinking about the governance and the money and the resources, we continue to put the person at the centre of the decisions that we take.
Okay.
So
just briefly.
Finally, it relates just back to the figure that Mary Scanlon highlighted about the 11% at care at reduction in people receiving care at home, and then later the figure for the delayed discharge bed days rising by 9%. Is it too cynical to say that there's a, how direct is that correlation?
Well, I mean, there's a simple correlation insofar as if resource outside the hospital decreases, pressure in the hospital increases. But on the other hand, If we get better at improving the health status, so the overall health and well-being of people who are leaving hospital, then they need less when they get out there. So again, it's not a one-way algorithm. If we get better at improving people's health status, then they need less care when they go out. If they're able to self-manage and self-care rather than being dependent on resource provided by the state, then that's in the interest of the individual, because they've more control over what they're doing, and it's the interest of the state because it's costing less. So this is something that is there's a complex set of interactions, but what we're doing is working to make sure that we make the best of what's within the health service and within local government to maximise the benefit for people.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener, and my personal congratulations on your appointment. Having looked through it, I think some of my colleagues have picked up on the fact that it's not everything is doom and gloom in the garden. There's obviously challenges, but there's some good points as well. I'll just carry on just a little bit from where Drew Smith was in terms of the care home provision. I think you've sort of almost gone there, but you pointed out the pressures on particular areas such as Edinburgh, Aberdeen, and I'm assuming that's due to property pricing and all the rest of it, something which you don't necessarily have a great deal of power over. And given the difficulties that's been pointed out in the report and elsewhere, and
I suppose, in the Health Committee as well. How do you anticipate the cost relations, and how do you feel that the boards are learning from what's happened over the past few years, where obviously the provision has, in certain areas, has become pressured, and is there some degree of end in sight? Is there a plan of action as to try and ease that pressure, in particularly in those particular areas that you can perhaps help either the local authority or whoever with the problem?
Well, I think you're right, first of all, Mr. Keir, to point out that the causes of pressure in different areas, different geographies, towns, cities, is different depending both on the economic circumstances and on the demography of the area. What we are doing is working with these areas that are under most pressure, as I mentioned, to ensure that they're thinking carefully about the solutions that are likely to work for them. There are some solutions that will work pan-Scotland, but there are other solutions, such as in relation to care homes and so forth, which will have to be tailored a bit more to the area in question. John Matheson and I had a very useful meeting yesterday with the Chief Executive of NHS Lothian and his finance director about some of the options they have for tackling some of the pressure that they face, including basically changing the way in which some beds are used so that there's step-down facilities available, working with the local authority to ensure that over time facilities can be transformed, that we currently own can be transformed into care home places. So these solutions will have to work for the specific localities, but yes, we're working hard at that. We're also at the Health and Social Care Management Board hearing a report every 2 weeks from the Director of Health and Social Care Integration to ensure that as a board we're cited on what's happening across Scotland and not simply focused on particular geographies. And we also discuss this regularly with the board, NHS board chief executives, to ensure that they too can learn from what's happening in other board areas.
Thanks. If I may, the other things that sort of spring out at me in terms of going through and the pressures, it's always occurred to me that the pressures on drugs, the generic type, whether it's patented or all the problems surrounding. Well, obviously, we have a new medicines fund, don't we? Was it 40 million? In terms of how all these new reforms that have come in are affecting the pressures that have been identified over the past year, I suppose, how do you feel about the coming year? Is it going to be a bit more manageable in dealing with these new drugs, the appropriation, whatever? Just your comments on that would be helpful.
Well, I'll ask Mr. Matheson to say what we're doing in terms of budget in relation to drugs in particular. I think, Mr. Keir, 2015-16 is going to be another tough year. The demographic trends are not going to start going downwards next year or the year after. We are going to face demands on the health service. There is growing demand from the public for the kinds of service that they want to receive. There is demand on the drugs budget. Mr. Matheson mentioned it as one of the most significant aspects of our budget. However, what I also know is that boards are working very hard indeed to ensure that they deliver local delivery plans that represent financial balance for the boards in 2015-16. I'm not going to claim it's going to be easy, but I do believe it's doable. Convener, with your permission, do you want Mr. Matheson to say something?
Thank you, Mr. Gray. 3 points, I think. One, from a strategic perspective, we have a policy prescription for excellence. In terms of our strategic direction, in terms of how we manage the pharmacy resource, not just the drugs resource, but the relationship with the community pharmacists, the relationship with the with drug companies. So we have that strategic direction, which is driven by our 2020 vision. Yes, it's important that we focus on the new pressures, new drug pressures coming along, but I go back to my previous point that we also need to look at the totality of how we spend the existing drug budget in terms of the £1.4 billion. We have a good generic rate. You mentioned, Mr. Keir, 83% is our level of generic prescribing. But 80% of our prescribing is repeat prescribing. So how do we manage that effectively? How is the engagement, not just with the GP, but with the primary care team in terms of how that is managed? The national therapeutic indicators around statins, around inhalers, around proton pump inhibitors. In terms of the detail around the financial resource, we do recognise the significance of drug pressures. We have, for 14-15, given an additional £10 million to NHS boards recognising the pressures they're facing in year, and we've given them an additional £30 million in respect of 15-16.
Yeah, OK, I'm aware of the time. I'll call it a day.
OK. Just a brief supplementary from Mary Scanlon, then I'll finish with that question.
Just a couple of points that were raised, and I just lumped them into one. But although Drew Smith didn't have an example, I feel I can use an example, given that it was on television earlier this week, although I don't have the patient's permission. But the patient is called Debbie Meehy, and she wasn't kept in the Ian Charles Hospital for 72 hours as a delayed discharge. She was, in fact, held in that hospital for over a year. And I know that you're all very well aware of it, and we have health and social integration that's supposed to solve all these problems. We've now had that for 2 years in the Highlands, and that's one patient that waited over 2 years. And can I just say, Convener, if I may, as an MSP for the Highlands since 1999, people are scared to speak out. They're scared to complain. And they'll say to me, well, say something, but don't mention my name, don't mention where I live, don't mention my condition, etc. And I've got a list of complaints for all the cancelled operations at Rakemore last week. But please don't mention my name, because I'm scared I'll get picked on or I'll get put to the bottom of the list. So I just want, Mr. Gray, and I think you perhaps do understand that, but the patients are scared to speak out, and the staff are scared to speak out. So my second question was really about Stuart McMillan talking about all the cuts from Westminster. The NHS budget at Westminster has been protected since 2010, and you've already spoken about additional consequentials that came to Scotland and NHS Highland as a result of increased spending at Westminster. So, Convener, I would find it helpful, instead of listening to threats of cuts down the line, etc. Obviously, nobody knows what is going to happen in May. If you would tell us in actual and real terms, what have been the changes in the NHS budget since 2010? I think that would be exceptionally helpful to this committee. And my final point, Convener, is, and there's so many figures here, but when it comes to a report card based on a policy of excellence, the biggest scare factor of the NHS is when your GP thinks, oh, I can't deal with you, I'll send you for an outpatient appointment. For that 12 weeks, you don't know what's wrong with you. That's a worrying, worrying time. And it's on the back of Drew Smith's point. And it's even more worrying that within this report that we have in front of us today, between March 2010 and March 2014, there was a 4,200% increase in the number of patients waiting more than 12 weeks for an outpatient appointment. 4,200%. It went up from 157 to 6754, and an increase of 34% in the number of people on the waiting list. Now, if my GP refers me to a consultant from that day forward, I'm worried about what he's saying. A 4,200% increase. So I just put those points on the record, Convener. The panel may wish to respond in writing or orally, but I felt I needed to say those points.
Mr. Gray.
What would be assistance, Convener? I think my offer would be that on the real terms changes in the budget since 2010, we would write to the committee so that that's clear. In terms of Ms. Scanlon's point about outpatients, I will read from the LDP guidance. which we've issued, having mentioned that this was a priority. Each and every NHS board is expected to achieve the 12-week outpatient standard, and the LDP should include a delivery trajectory. Long waits for outpatient appointments are unacceptable, and NHS boards must also eradicate waits over 16 weeks, which is the long stop. So that's what we've said in response to your point.
Instead of better.
Well, we now want to make it better. The third point I will respond to very briefly is on patients being afraid to come forward. I genuinely wish to place on record, Convener, that patients should have nothing to fear from coming forward. And if they believe they do, and if they have evidence to support that, then I would be happy for them to come to me direct. If it's an issue in terms of clinical care, Chief Medical Officer will review it. If it's an issue in terms of administrative standards, I and my senior team will review it. I would say for staff, there is a confidential helpline, which is not run by us. It's provided, paid for by us, but not run by us. There is also patient opinion, where people can put up their details anonymously if they wish. I would be genuinely anxious to encourage everyone in Scotland, if they have a concern, to raise it. And I give my personal commitment that that is something I take very, very seriously indeed. So if any member around this table or elsewhere has evidence that individuals, whether patients or staff, are afraid to raise a concern, I do want to know about it.
Can I just ask, in terms of a concluding question, Mr. Gray, this is my first time in the committee, and I think your approach today has been open and transparent, and I think you want to continue that. But by way of background, I think it would be helpful to hear from you perhaps some of your frustrations in terms of the fact that some of these targets that we referred to earlier haven't been met, and you know, some of this will be in respect of some poor management practices that have been in place throughout the various boards that are represented in Scotland. And I just wonder, by way of background, can you, not naming names, but share your concerns and your frustrations in that respect, because you are here before us today to, you know, represent those. We put forward to you our concerns in respect to that. So you must have, you know, some personal frustrations that perhaps those discussions take place internally within your organisation that you convey to the various board members and various managers who, due to poor management practices, perhaps some of these targets that should have been met with the resources that have been made available have not been met.
Well, let me give one or two points on that. I think, so for example, we see excellent performance in NHS Tayside on delivering the A&E four-hour wait target, and I'm very keen that other boards learn from that and learn from it quickly, and Mr. Hunter and others are active in ensuring that's the case. I think that there was a critical report put in by NHS Healthcare Improvement Scotland on NHS Lanarkshire in December of 2013, 17th of December 2013. That did point to some management practices that were not efficient and to some governance structures that were unclear. NHS Lanarkshire have taken that very seriously and tackled it, but yes, it was a frustration to me that some of that arose because there were unclear management procedures, unclear governance arrangements. And I'm now asking other boards to ensure that they take on the lessons learned from Lanarkshire. Members in this committee will be aware of the difficulties that NHS Grampian have faced. To start with the positive, we had the annual review of NHS Grampian on Monday of this week. It's like a different place. There have been significant improvements in NHS Grampian, but of course I'm frustrated that it takes a lot of time and input to get us there. But I would want to say that Malcolm Wright, the interim chief executive there, has made a big difference. And what I'm seeing there is clinicians who were previously disengaged, unhappy, in some cases behaving quite counterproductively, now coming forward and saying we want to be part of the solution. It does frustrate me that we seem at times to operate in a way that leads to frustration within the health service, which then bubbles out in doctors, nurses, other professionals feeling that they need to express themselves in the press. I'm not seeking to inhibit the right of people to speak up when they think things are going wrong. Indeed, quite the contrary, as I've said in response to Ms. Scanlon's point. But it does frustrate me, therefore, that we don't yet, in every case, have the processes and procedures and the governance in place that allow people to express their concerns internally and have them dealt with. One of the things, though, I'd want to say, Convener, is this. I think that in the health service, there's a great deal of excellence that tends to go unnoticed, and it does frustrate me that the public discourse tends regularly to be about the few things that have gone wrong. And believe me, when they do go wrong, we want to know about it, we want to fix it. And I'll say in passing, if we make mistakes or harm people, we should apologise for it and should do it without reserve. But it does frustrate me that all the discourse is about what isn't going well as opposed to much that is. And my last point, if I may, Convener, is this. Recognising that you and a number of other members are new to this committee or returning to it, if you would find a private briefing from me, senior officials and senior clinicians helpful, we'd be happy to provide it. That's not me trying to say I don't want to be on the record. Very happy to be on the record on all matters connected with performance, delivery and accountability. But if a private briefing would be helpful, we'd be delighted to provide it.
Can I just say finally on that point then, in terms of the poor management practices, which happens in many organisations, and I'm not claiming that it's exclusive to your organisation, but in terms of the consequences for those who have engaged in poor management practices and it has been brought to their attention that that's the case, and you've sought to reconcile that and to make sure that they are taking it forward positively. If they don't, and we revisit this at some stage in the future and it hasn't been met, I mean, would it be your case, I think would be expected any organisation, that individuals in those positions shouldn't continue in their positions if they haven't met the obligations that were set to them. And I'm not asking for specifics, I'm just taking it as read that, of course, that would be the position.
So the employers of most staff in the NHS in Scotland are, of course, the boards themselves. But I've made it very clear to the chairs and the chief executives of NHS Scotland boards that I expect high standards of performance. I expect people to be given the opportunity to recover if they haven't done well, to have that drawn to their attention and to be given the opportunity to redress the situation. But it's certainly my view that if, having gone through a proper performance management process, any individual, not just in the NHS but in public service generally, is not able to meet the standards of the job that are required, then they either have to go to a different job at a different level where they can meet the requirements or move on to something else.
Okay. Can I thank the panel for the time this morning? And I'd like to conclude the committee for 5 minutes. Sorry, not conclude, suspend the committee for 5 minutes. Thank you, colleagues. We are now at agenda item number four. Can I welcome the Auditor General for Scotland, Gillian Willman, and Assistant Director Mark Roberts, Senior Manager from Audit Scotland. Can I ask the Auditor General to come forward with a brief statement?
Thank you.
Sorry, Caroline Gardner, sorry.
All right.
I don't know why I've got...
Don't worry, Convener, that's fine. Thank you, and Happy New Year to the committee. I'm presenting this report on the 2013-14 of the audit of the Scottish Police Authority under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000. The Scottish Police Authority and the Police Service of Scotland came into being on the 1st of April 2013, and 2013-14 was the first year for which it produced accounts. The SPA's accounts include the financial results of the Police Service of Scotland. As the committee is aware, the process of bringing together the eight predecessor forces and the Scottish Police Services Authority was a challenging task, and I undertook to keep the committee informed about progress since my last report in 2013. Significant progress has been made and continues to be made. I'd like briefly to highlight three key issues. The first is the pressure that the SPA's finance function was under during 2013-14. This was in part due to the substantial challenge of bringing together the finance systems of the eight predecessor forces and the SPSA, and in part due to the fact that numerous finance staff left under the SPA's voluntary redundancy and early retirement scheme. In addition, there were protracted discussions to establish where responsibility for the finance function should lie between the SPA and the Police Service of Scotland. This led to a delay in appointing a permanent director of finance and also generated uncertainty among finance staff about their future permanent roles and responsibilities. The SPA appointed a permanent director of financial accountability in 2014, and this puts the SPA in a good position for the future. The second issue arises from the pressures experienced by SPA's finance function during 2013-14. The auditor, Gillian Woolman on my left, gave an unqualified opinion on the SPA's annual report and accounts for the year, but unusually she expressed a modified conclusion on the matters that she's required to report on by exception. She concluded that for certain areas, adequate accounting records had not been kept during 2013-14. This meant that the audit was difficult to complete and, more importantly, limited the information available to support decision-making by the SPA and Police Scotland during the year. Thirdly, the auditor assessed progress against the recommendations in my November 2013 report on police reform. As highlighted in Exhibit 1 of today's report, the SPA has made progress or completed the majority of these recommendations. The key area where work remains in progress is the development of a long-term, by which, for the avoidance of doubt, I mean into the mid-2020s, a long-term financial strategy that takes into account all the additional cost pressures facing the SPA. Having such a strategy in place will provide a roadmap to help ensure a sustainable future for policing in Scotland. The SPA is continuing to develop its strategy based on its strategies for workforce, estate, fleet, ICT systems and procurement. And I've asked the SPA's auditor to continue to monitor progress in this work as part of the 2014-15 audit. Alongside me are Gillian Woolman, an Assistant Director with Audit Scotland and the appointed auditor responsible for the audit of the Scottish Police Authority, and Mark Roberts, a Senior Manager with Audit Scotland who leads on our work in the justice area. As always, Convener, we're happy to answer the committee's questions, and you'll forgive me if I may rely on Gillian and Mark more than usual given the state of my voice today. Thank you.
Thank you to the Auditor General. First of all, can I thank you for your statement. I think we've got questions from Colin. First of all, Colin Keir. Sorry, Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Clearly, the important thing here is that the auditor gave an unqualified opinion, and I assume that the basis of that was that despite the deficiencies that they encountered, they were able to satisfy themselves as to the accounts of the SPA. Would that be correct?
Absolutely, Mr. Beattie. I'll ask Gillian, if I may, to talk you through what happened and how she arrived at a clean opinion with the modification that I've described.
Thank you. That's clearly a very evident question to ask in these circumstances. At all times, the external audit was carried out in accordance with the audit guide of Audit Scotland in order to see all of the audit evidence and seek all of the information and explanations we required in order to reach a final audit opinion. The audit opinion on the financial statements was an unqualified one. However, since 2010-11, there has been an extra part to the audit opinion which highlights areas you may have to report by exception, and consequently the modification arises in that area which relates to the adequacy of accounting records and information and explanations we received in particular areas. But I would like to assure the committee that it was very much a full-scope audit that was undertaken in order to reach the unqualified audit opinion on the financial statements.
And I think that's a very important point to put on record. Given the scope of the merger which took place, which I think is almost unprecedented in Scotland at least, bringing together 9 different financial systems, was the level of difficulty in the first audit commensurate with the complexity of bringing all that together?
I think, as I said in my opening statement, first of all, we absolutely recognise that complexity. There's no doubt this was a very big merger in any terms, and that would always have had an impact. Over and above that, there were the delays that were caused in agreeing who had responsibility for the finance functions between SPA and Police Scotland, and the consequent delays in appointing key members of staff. Adding into that the departures of staff under the voluntary severance and early retirement schemes, the uncertainty that remaining staff experienced about what their jobs would be, all of that added to the unavoidable complexity that Jill and her team had to deal with, I think.
Can I ask maybe just a couple of specifics on these inadequacies? I mean, in your submission to the audit committee here, you talk about adequate accounting records have not been kept. What actually was that? Can you define that?
Yes, I'm happy to respond to the detail of that question. The actual audit opinion does highlight its aspects of the accounting records in the areas of fixed assets, bank and cash, and supporting documentation for the calculation of key accruals in the balance sheet at year end. So, what we were looking for and what we discussed through the planning process and working closely with finance officers was our expectations about what accounting records would be readily available in the course of the audit work during the year 2014. What did happen in due course was that there was a delay in the production and passing over of particular records relating to fixed assets. When they were forthcoming after a period of time, they weren't right up to date for the transactions of that year, but we worked closely with client officers to determine where the transactions were recorded, and it was directly into the financial ledger. Consequently, we revised our audit approach and we did additional audit work than we might otherwise have done. So that gives you an idea for that particular area.
So just to clarify that, it wasn't that the records were incorrect, it was they were incomplete at that point. They weren't up to date. Is that correct?
Yes, so we were seeking audit evidence for the year 2013-14. Normally, for the audit of fixed assets, we would be looking at fixed asset registers. We would have expected them to have been up to date, and it was only at the end of August 2014, which several months later, that after the year end which we were auditing, there was clarity that they hadn't been kept up to date. However, the transactions had been recorded elsewhere directly on the financial ledger, but it had taken time to receive those explanations to enable us to then progress with the audit work quite a bit later than we would otherwise have done so.
Okay, so there were delays and there's obviously some cost involved in that, I would imagine. Can you quantify that?
We're currently discussing with the client the additional time that was incurred and what that means in terms of cost.
You have a ballpark?
So we haven't raised that directly with the client at this stage.
Okay. You're talking about property, plant, equipment and so on, accruals in that regard. Is that the only problem that was encountered? I mean, that seems to be the main focus of what you're talking about, but was there other aspects of the accounting?
We have produced a year-end report, an annual report that has gone to members of the Scottish Police Authority. We also produced reports during the year, interim management letters, and again, those have gone to the Audit and Risk Committee, where we've highlighted weaknesses in the areas of systems of internal control. But the full report at year-end is quite extensive, but for the purpose of the audit opinion, we drew out those areas that we felt were of such materiality to the overall opinion, and those are the areas we homed in on.
Okay. Would you say that the deficiencies you found were broadly commensurate, coming back to my original point, with the complexity of the merger of 9 different areas? Because presumably these areas were all using different systems and everything, and it would be... Although the principles of the accounting might be the same, the actual physicality of bringing it all together within a fairly short period must be quite difficult.
Yes. The organisation that had responsibility for the preparation of the financial accounts was in no doubt as to the size of the challenge, and we, as the external auditors, were in no doubt as to the size of the challenge for the first year of these 2 new organisations. Nevertheless, over the period of time and over the period of the audit, there were additional weaknesses that came to light, and as well as us identifying findings that required amendment in the accounts between the draft and the final, the client also identified additional information that came to light at their end, which meant changes had to be made to the accounts.
Would you say that the SPA finance people were aware of these deficiencies and were working on them, or were they unaware?
There were changes in personnel over this period of time leading the finance functions, and they too had to seek and work with a wider community of finance officers across Scotland to glean key pieces of information, and some of that information came late, so that was internal communications.
I think, Convener, could I just add to that by saying the underlying causes come back to the 2 things that I highlighted in my opening statement, the delay in agreeing where responsibility would sit and the consequent turnover and instability of staffing up until a point after the end of the first year. Those posts have now been filled and people have got much more certainty about their roles and responsibilities in future. But that period from before the establishment of the SPA and Police Scotland to the period after the end of the financial year for filling some key posts meant there was a great deal of pressure on those individuals, and that lack of an ability to make progress with the things that I think we would all agree would be the basics for good internal control and good financial management and reporting.
Now, you said you'd issued reports on various aspects to the police authority, yes. Have you had responses on that? Have they taken them on board? Are they actioning them?
Yes, it's very much part of our normal practice of any audit that we issue interim management letters during the course of the year. All of our findings are discussed with officers before the finalisation of the report. We get management responses as to how they're going to take forward the actions. The reports are discussed at the Audit and Risk Committee, and there's effective scrutiny by members to ensure that officers are engaged with the issues that internal and external audit raise. And yes, we're confident that actions are being taken forward to address these areas.
And will you be following up on that on a continuing basis?
We will.
My first question is in relation to the recommendations. As a member of the Audit Committee, I would imagine the recommendations are about scrutiny, effective spend and everything. I was actually surprised to see that 7 out of 8 recommendations are recommending that they continue to work together. Does Police Scotland and SPA need to be reminded by the Auditor General and Audit Scotland to work together?
I think it's worth reminding ourselves that the recommendations on which I'm reporting progress this time were recommendations that appeared in my original report in November 2013. And at that stage, there had quite recently been an agreement about who would play which roles in relation to the central services required, and the emergence of more clarity about who would take lead responsibility for which issues. So the recommendations date back more than a year, we're now reporting on progress, and I certainly feel it's good news that for most of those recommendations, we're now seeing them as either complete or very much in progress. I'm bringing to the attention of the committee, given the level of interest there's been in the creation of this new service over the period of its life since April 2013.
Take for granted that the public spend and the single police force that the two people at the head would work together. My second question is a follow-on from Colin Beattie's, and although you state in your conclusion, paragraph 9, certain accounting records were not adequate, you go on to say, and difficulties were encountered in conducting the audit. Now, I've heard the response about the accounting records of the different police authorities not being the same, and etc. But what difficulties did you encounter on top of that in conducting the audit?
The two are very much related in terms of trying to establish where the up-to-date accounting records were, who was responsible for them at that time, and gleaning sufficient audit evidence that was passed over to the audit team for us to carry out our standard audit work and to reach conclusions based on the assurance that we could draw out. And again, I think this links up very much to the fact that at the time there was it was a period of transition for the finance teams as they came together, some departed, some roles were changing, and some permanent roles and functions were not yet known at that time.
You see, apart from the inadequate accounts and difficulties, but we'll leave that one there. The third point, Convener, the ICT system, I understand, is still under development. I also understand it's been postponed again until September 2016. I wonder if you can give us an update on that and how that will affect duplication or how that will affect potential savings going forward. And just at the same time, I could perhaps ask about the payroll system, which I understand in certain areas is currently administered by local authorities, but my understanding is there will be a single payroll system in March this year. So the ICT system and the payroll system, can you give us an update on that, on how it will affect the duplication and the savings that we are all expecting?
I'll kick off, if I may, Mrs. Scanlon, by saying that what we've done in this report isn't to do fresh audit work on new areas. We've done the work required for Gillian to sign her audit opinion and to look at progress against the 8 recommendations that were in my November 2013 report. Mark may want to pick up on the broader question of ICT and the way we're planning to look at that in future, and Jill may want to add to it.
In terms of ICT, some of my colleagues have been in discussion with HMICS with regards to kind of what work's going to be going on over the next few months in terms of monitoring and evaluating progress on the implementation of the I6 programme. As the Auditor General says, we don't have any more detail based on this report, but it's one of the key areas of ICT development across the public sector that we're very interested in monitoring and assessing as work goes on.
Jill may want to add briefly on the payroll system that you asked about.
Yes, in the course of the 2013-14 audit on which we're reporting, we're right up to date with the arrangements for payroll that continued, a legacy arrangement with those local authorities that had been acting on behalf of the joint boards before in this area. In terms of going forward, and we certainly highlighted in our interim management letter, their attention to the service level agreements and the length of period that they continued for. We have yet to find out more information as we do undertake our 2014-15 planning to determine the arrangements that are going to be in place for the payroll system going forward. So I've yet to glean that information as the auditor.
It's on target for March 2015, like 6 weeks away. You still don't have the full information going forward. That's perhaps something we can...
As the external auditor, I'm not in a position to say fine. To you whether the payroll system is on track for March 2015.
Can I just, Convener, ask Mark Roberts, the information you have, is it true to say that the ICT system has been postponed again until September 2016?
I don't know, to be definitely honest. What I'll do is I'll come back to the committee on that and confirm once I've spoken to some of my colleagues. We had a meeting with HMICS to discuss this very subject yesterday, so if it's all right, Convener, we can reply to the committee in writing.
So just a brief supplementary from Colin.
Your guidance on this. We haven't really had any evidence on ICT and payroll systems and so on, so we've really no basis for discussing at the moment, I would say.
Okay. I mean, if it's information that can be provided, it's not going to be unhelpful, but I don't think we should seek to take evidence on it, yeah. But if it's information that can be helpfully provided by way of background.
That's all. Police Scotland's corporate strategy.
Yeah. But if it's information that can be provided, but, you know, I don't think we're looking to take any further evidence in that respect. It's what's before us today that we'll clarify, we'll work on. Nigel Don.
Good morning, colleagues. I'm just wondering if I could clarify my understanding of what the words mean, and forgive me if I get into a very simple engineering kind of words, but am I right in thinking that you get an unqualified report on the accounts if the numbers add up? But that the comments that you've made are essentially about the systems that you found, because as an auditor you really want to be convinced that all the stuff you haven't seen, because you never see everything, is credible.
That's right. The audit opinion is giving a professional view that the financial statements of the organisation give a true and fair view of the financial picture in line with all of the professional standards that financial reporting has to comply with and that we do as auditors. And there's no question but that the financial statements give that clear and that true and fair view. What the modified conclusion conveys to me as Auditor General and onto you as this committee is that the process of getting to that opinion was more difficult because of the inadequate records during the year than we would expect it to be. That is an unusual thing to happen. As Jill said, this requirement came in 2010-11, and this is the first time there's been a modified conclusion. Given the level of public interest, I think that's worth drawing to the committee's attention, but very much in the context that we also recognise the improvements that are being made in financial management and financial reporting within both SPA and Police Scotland.
And to return to the point that my colleague Colin Beattie's just made, if you're putting nine organisations together, one really can't be surprised. But, and this I guess is my second point, Convener, you spoke, Auditor General, about voluntary redundancies and the loss of presumably fairly important people in the context of the systems that you're talking about. I'm just wondering whether anybody has reflected on the wisdom of that voluntary redundancy process and whether perhaps people have learned a lesson. I mean, my recollection from my time in industry was that voluntary redundancies were not available to everybody because there were some people who plainly were needed. And I'm just wondering whether that's a lesson that might have been learned in the context of this for the public service in general?
You're absolutely right about the general point. Our former report on managing mergers in the public sector made that point about needing to be clear who were the key people and the key skills that were required and making sure they were in place during the transition. I think there were particular challenges in this case because of the number of bodies being merged, the eight former police authorities plus the Scottish Police Services Authority, the fact that they were dispersed around Scotland, and the fact that one of the rationales for the merger was to make savings that would help to ensure sustainable policing. Now, those challenges were there anyway, but the delay in agreeing who would take what roles and therefore which staff would be needed made that more difficult, made it harder to make sure that people were kept during the critical period, were available to build the new systems, and frankly were available to provide information to Gillian and her team when they were doing the audit. So again, the genuine complexities of doing this were made more difficult by the delays that were encountered. And I think it's worth noting again that as well as making the audit more challenging, and that's a fact, and I'm very grateful to Gillian and her team for the work they put in to being able to deliver a clean audit certificate, it also meant that the information available to Police Scotland and the SPA to inform their decision-making was not as rounded and complete as it might have been during the year. And that has an effect as well on the way public money is used. That's part of why I'm bringing this report to the committee today, while fully recognising the progress that continues to be made in resolving those issues.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I'm just wondering, Convener, whether I could just, this simple point of information, are you going to go back for next year's annual report?
Jill will be auditing the accounts of the SPA, including Police Scotland, every year. It's part of what we're required to do. My decision on whether to report to this committee and to the Parliament depends on what comes out of that audit, as it does in every other case. At some point, I'm sure we will go back and have another in-depth look at the performance of Police Scotland, and particularly the progress in developing and delivering a financial strategy. But for now, there are no firm plans for when that will take place.
Yeah, thank you.
I mean, I think everyone recognises that it was always going to be a complicated business to bring these eight forces, you know, plus the other boards, together, and that isn't a surprise. But it wouldn't be surprising that you would need to have somebody in charge of the finances, and you would need to be clear about who that was. I mean, so we've had this kind of extraordinary spat between Police Scotland and the police authority has been played out in public, but. What you're showing us is kind of the underlying reality of what that kind of relationship between those two organisations created in terms of the flow of information and recording information properly. I mean, you describe it here as a protracted negotiations to decide who was doing what. I mean, it was a squabble, basically, wasn't it?
You'll understand, Mr. Smith, that as auditors we aim to use language very clearly about what's going on, and we reported on the history of the merger in full in November 2013. I think what we are seeing now is the legacy of the problems that were experienced in the early months leading up to the merger and the transition to the new arrangements. There was uncertainty about the intention of who should be leading on the provision of support services, whether it should be the SPA or Police Scotland. That took time to resolve, and eventually the Scottish Government moved in and brokered an agreement between the two parties. We're now seeing real progress, but we're also seeing the legacy of that delay coming through.
In order to have confidence in the arrangements that now exist are going to be successful, is it necessary to understand where the responsibilities lay? This, you know, was between either organisation. Do you put it squarely and say that both of these organisations had different views about how this should work? That's been resolved, and we just need to move on. Is there a particular view about one organisation was more overbearing than the other about the way it wanted to do things, or there was a real difference of the kind of way they wanted to go about doing this job?
I think this was a core issue in the report that I published in November 2013, and as is very often the case with problems and situations that are to a great extent about the roles that individuals play and the different perceptions they bring, it's not possible to say that one person or one organisation was responsible. What I did say at that stage, though, was that the lack of clarity about who would do what that was inherent in the legislation and the wider planning didn't help, and that there may have been scope for the government to have helped to resolve that more quickly. Now, that's a different thing, and we're not looking to reopen those questions. What we're saying now is that there were consequences of those delays during 2013-14. In Gillian's view particularly, the staffing has now reached a stable state, which is a good thing, and we'll continue to monitor the way in which the people who are now in post are delivering what they're responsible for in terms of good financial management, good financial reporting, and overall the good use of public money to support policing in Scotland.
Thank you. On paragraph 9 of the document, you highlight the issue of suppliers being paid in a timely manner. How much of an issue actually was this? And was this as a consequence of maybe that some bills and invoices maybe not being paid in the previous financial year that then carried forward to this particular year?
Jill to answer that in detail, but I think the point I was trying to make in that paragraph was that the finance staff within SPA and Police Scotland were working very hard to keep the show on the road, and that there was inevitably within that a process of prioritisation, what are the most important things to be done. Jill, do you want to add to that?
Yes, I guess as the external auditors, we're looking at the financial accounts, and in this paragraph we're trying to provide assurances that the management accounting throughout the year was being maintained. That was an important area for informed decision-making to take place throughout the year. So this paragraph is intended to give confidence about those finance staff that were in post were working very hard and they knew their priorities were at the interface to ensure supplies and pay were all kept up to date during that first year.
With that particular part in this paragraph, was it an issue?
No, there was not an issue for the payment of suppliers.
Right, okay, thank you very much.
Can I just say conclusion? One question in terms of, the actual process that was followed, which we've talked about, we are looking at substantial sums of money in terms of what the both organisations are responsible for. So obviously, public scrutiny is an important, you're playing an important role in that. In terms of reaching this conclusion, though, is it something that you've looked at when you've made the demands and organisations of the information that you've expected to for them to respond to you on? Have you not looked at it in reflection and thought perhaps there should have been more preparatory work done to ensure that information was provided so that your job would have been much easier than it sounded as if it ended up in the end?
You're absolutely right, Convener. Policing in Scotland costs about £1.8 billion a year, and it's a service that we all rely on and expect to be there when we need it. In my report in November 2013, the point that I was making was that for a change of that scale, the run-up period was quite short for good reasons, and the areas that were left uncertain left open the potential for the delays that we then saw in agreeing who would play some of these key roles in managing and reporting the finances. Now, in terms of lessons learned, the committee has had the Scottish Government's assurance that those lessons will be learned for any future moves of this sort. But I think the underlying point that I'd like to bring out is that for any organisation spending public money and delivering public services, having good financial information, good financial records isn't a thing that we're only interested because we're being counted as auditors, but one of the underlying ways in which we all know as citizens and you as parliamentarians know that public money is being properly used and properly accounted for. I'm very pleased that the amount of progress that's been made now has been made within SPA and Police Scotland, and I felt it was appropriate to bring to this committee's attention the challenges that were experienced as a result of those delays during its first year of operation.
But I wonder though, and as I say, some of us here today are new to the committee, so we don't know all the background to this. But I do wonder what lessons have actually been learned from the process, because they say significant public funds. I can think of other organisations who receive quite significant public scrutiny and whose information has been asked of them, and they see it as an absolute given that information just has to be provided. Other organisations can't continue to function. I suppose the question I'm asking is, yes, you've highlighted some of these areas where there's information provided, and that's been provided, and that's led to the report you provided today. I suppose the point then is that somewhere along the line, the information hasn't been collated properly, or the information has not been able to be collated. What lessons have been learned to ensure that for the organisations, in terms of the new organisation that's been created, that's something that's been dealt with, and I would expect to have been dealt in quite a robust manner to ensure that these significant public funds that have been spent here are being recorded properly.
Within SPA and Police Scotland, I think we're very confident that now the foundations are in place for good financial management in future. The people are there, the roles are clear, the backlog of work in terms of pulling these information and the systems together is well underway in Jill's estimation, and we'll continue to monitor that. The bigger question of changes and mergers like this in future, the committee has the government's commitment to making sure that lessons are learned in future. Clearly, change on this scale doesn't happen very often, which is one of the reasons why it's so challenging. But where there are future mergers or reforms that bring up the same sorts of questions, the committee has my assurance that we'll continue to be looking closely at it and making sure that the lessons are being learned at an early stage, not just when the reform is complete at the end of the process.
Okay. Any further questions from colleagues? Okay, can I thank the Auditor General and the team for the contribution today and allow some time for the changeover to take place. Let's just leave. Okay, colleagues, can I move on to agenda item number six? And before we move on to that, can I just advise colleagues that the former Glasgow North College was a college which I was a constituency member for up until 2011. So just thought, I understand I don't have to declare it as an interest, but I just thought it would draw the committee's attention to that. So before us today, colleagues, we have responses from the Scottish Government and the Scottish Funding Council on the Auditor General Section 22 report on the 2012-2013 audited accounts of the North Glasgow College. Because you will be aware there's been a number of changes in committee membership since this was last discussed on the 19th of November. Members should note that the North Glasgow College no longer exists. Its merger took place on the 1st of November 2013 with Stow College and John Wheatley College to form Glasgow Kelvin College. In addition, the submissions before us today from the committee's consideration on the 19th of November and the Auditor General's report from the Glasgow Kelvin College. I wonder if I could invite members to comment on the submissions they've received and any action which they would propose. Colin Beattie.
I have to say that the submissions we've received don't change my opinion on this from the last time this was discussed. I think the whole thing is absolutely outrageous, the way it's been handled. I think that the fact that the main college concern no longer exists creates enormous difficulties, but reading through everything, there seems to be every evidence that, at the very least, there should be some sort of investigation in respect of negligence, possibly even incompetence, to be quite frank. I feel very strongly on this. The whole thing has been so badly handled. You look at some of the points that have been raised, which say the Remuneration Committee hadn't met for a number of years, it received inadequate management support, was unaware of SFC guidance, and you go through all the paperwork on this, and frankly, I would have thought it merited a proper investigation as to how this happened. Now, this committee is obviously not an investigating committee, but maybe with your guidance, Convener, where can we take this next? If the entity still existed, it might be easier, but it doesn't exist. Where can we take this? Where can we escalate this for further investigation?
Okay, Mary Scanlon.
Well, I absolutely, totally agree with Colin. I think it's outrageous, and I think it's actually a sad reflection on the auditing procedures. We're constantly being told lessons have been learned, things are in place, we've now got merged colleges, and in the future they will adhere to a public finance manual, and this won't happen again. But the fact is that it did happen, and we had individuals awarding themselves around £750,000 of taxpayers' money. Thank you very much. And their defence was they hadn't met for a number of years, inadequate management support, unaware of SFC guidance. I read the Scottish Funding Council response to this, and to be honest, I really wasn't impressed by that either. Guidance is on the website, and if only you'd had a look at the website, everything would be fine. So I think it's passing the buck, gold-plated passing the buck. But I do feel, Convener, I don't know what the way forward is, but, the entity doesn't exist, as Colin Beattie has said. I think as an audit committee, £750,000 is money that would go a long way towards home care and other issues within our public service rather than being awarded to college principals and vice principals. I don't know what we can do. It seems to me that they have probably got away with it. I'm pleased that this was brought to our attention by the auditors. I think it was Scott Thornton. And I would like advice as to how we can go forward, or advice as to if we can take this forward. But I'm pleased to put on the record that I fully agree with Colin Keir. And the information, that very concerning information we've had around these huge payoffs.
Any other colleagues want to Sure, no.
A simple question. Just in terms of these particular reports and the level of work that's taking place on this, is a kind of a similar piece of work going to take place for the other merged institutions? Yeah, well, I see the report.
Combity.
Just one thing. In the submission from the Scottish Funding Council, the last page there, it says it should be noted that the Scottish Public Finance Manual does not affect the non-incorporated colleges. How can we reassure ourselves that they're adhering to proper guidelines, if there are guidelines, in order to ensure that they don't encounter the same problems? I mean, they're publicly funded bodies. There's got to be some accountability. How do we do that? How are they accountable?
We do need an assurance that this can't happen again. Yeah. I think that would be very helpful, and I think it's a good point.
Okay. I think from the contributions from colleagues today, it's the colleagues feel strongly, and the response so far is unsatisfactory. So can I suggest to colleagues that we write to the Scottish Funding Council expressing their concerns and the fact that we're not satisfied with the latest response and seek their guidance in terms of how we make it clear to them that we wish to take it forward and to seek a further response to them on that basis. Is that acceptable? Okay. Thank you, colleagues. Move on to agenda item number 7. And advise colleagues that we are invited to consider a further response to the committee's report on the NHS financial performance 2012-13 and the NHS waiting lists published last June. The committee considered the Scottish Government's substantive response to the committee's report on the 5th of November 2014 and agreed to note it. The response, as members have before them today, is the final outstanding part of that response. Members will note that the response explains the terms of improving the terminology used to report the NHS's performance. The Scottish Government intends to provide a focused set of priorities and standards. Those standards are summarised in page 12 of the local delivery plan guidance. Just draw colleagues back to the discussion we had earlier today with the evidence that we received from led by Mr. Gray, and they give a commitment to come back to the committee on the very issues that we have before us in this agenda item. Can I suggest that, given that he's given the commitment to come back to us, and that would satisfactorily deal with this particular item?
Okay.
Is that agreed?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank colleagues for that, and can we now move into private session?